As we all know, India is the world's second largest cultivator of bamboo. According to the Union Ministry of Agriculture and Farmer Welfare, India's annual bamboo production is estimated at 3.23 million tons. However, despite all this, the country's share in the global bamboo trade and commerce is only 4%. Till now, there are various studies on bamboo as a material, which has emphasized its strengths and limitations. There is a need to explore innovations in bamboo to solve these limitations, which can lead to increase in India's share in the global bamboo trade and commerce. We should promote bamboo as a future material to make our country self-reliant in bamboo industry, that is Atmanirbhar Bharat. Hence this webinar to deliberate various issues from policymakers, architects and industry experts. We are fortunate to have Honorable Suresh Prabhu sir with us to deliver inaugural address. It is a great honor for me to introduce and welcome Honorable Suresh Prabhu sir to the G7 and G20 member of Parliament Rajya Sabha. He has handled several ministries in past, from commerce and industry, civil aviation, railways, environment, power to heavy industries. He has also been chairman of the task force on interlinking of rivers. He is a chartered accountant by profession, a man of action, having passion for undertaking reforms, scripting turnarounds, and achieving superlative results by working in mission mode. An advocate for decisive growth-driven change, he is well respected for his integrity, passion, and commitment towards society at large. Sri Suresh Prabhu facilitated a policy decision that led to India becoming signatory to International Network on Bamboo and Ratan's Treaty in 1998. INBAR is intergovernmental body dedicated to research and promotion of bamboo, headquartered in Beijing, China. National Mission on Bamboo Application under Science and Technology Department was formed by NDA government due to his consistent efforts. Today, we are privileged to have an opportunity to listen to him this evening. On behalf of all, I welcome you, sir, and may I request Honorable Suresh Prabhu, sir, to deliver inaugural address.
So thank you very much, Dr. Yadav, for giving this opportunity. For me, it's a to be here because of many reasons. One, hosted by lady whose family I know for a long time. Therefore, I'm very happy that she's now occupying the key position. This time. Secondly, I was on the board of Manipal University for a very long time. In such time that I became the minister again under Narendra Modi ji, and had to resign from 150 organizations, including Manipal University. Thirdly, this is a very interesting program which is a subject which is so close to my heart. Of course, come to it later, one of my co-panelists have been doing a great job, it's great, and I will come to that. So there are many reasons for me to be here, and I'm very happy to be here. Share my joy as well as the possibilities of expanding this bamboo sector into so many different aspects. As you know, bamboo is a grass rag, not timber. When I was a minister of forest, I realized that we need to do many things to prevent deforestation. The way to do that to find out why people actually cut trees, because there is a natural tendency to use into our day-to-day life, which is part of the culture, tradition, and also historically. We have been using it on a large scale. So to prevent it, we can make alternate use crop available. It can be substituting timber that will solve the problem. Bamboo solves the twin purposes, can avoid deforestation, at the same time meet with the kind of use that people want the wood to be. Also, bamboo, very fast growing variety. And Mr. Kalpe and his colleagues have made up substantial research so that fast growing varieties are also put to use in many parts of the country. You cut bamboo, again, you generate the shortest possible time. So again, the bamboo is available. And bamboo also can serve environmental costs and also can serve economic costs. Can create huge employment, and I'm very happy Yadav, you mentioned about example of other countries where they have benefited immensely by creating jobs from. But where the jobs will come, it's not just come from plantation, it will come from value addition. We can put bamboo to variety of uses, we can create employment generation through value addition, through downstream activity that can happen on bamboo plant or bamboo processing. And therefore, we guessed at that time that Northeast states, 8 states in those that part of India, they themselves can create full employment for all the citizens of Northeast to do value addition. Not just cutting bamboo and just burning it or putting it to various uses. Of course, we need it. Culturally, our last journey from this planet also happens on the bamboo. So we need it for that. But while we perform a large journey, till that time we can put it to a variety of economic uses. And to do that, I met all the chief ministers of all the northeastern states and convinced them that they must do it. They started working on it. But I must thank Honorable Prime Minister Atal Bihari Vajpayee for putting this into reality. When we signed a treaty, Cabinet had to clear it, chaired by Prime Minister Vajpayee, and he fully supported it. And now I am very happy that Prime Minister Narendra Modi is taking the next step to make bamboo a real successful mission to make change the lives of the people. So employment, besides environment, can create huge millions of jobs. Economy can benefit immensely because of the value addition, the economic output will come into play. Therefore, it has also export potential, as you mentioned, international trade. So I had invited all the merchant exporters to tell them, why don't you help the bamboo growers, bamboo cultivators, as well as bamboo processors, give them design so that they will design it and we can export it. With brilliant designs, we can have a huge market. But of course, while we exports have to happen, I'm very happy to set entrepreneurship of people like Mr. Tarpe Kovar that they set up has resulted into now bamboo being used in variety of uses. People are making houses, people are making furniture. If I was a Minister of Aviation, I'd also said that all aviations prepared to use bamboo. I'd said that in many, many ministries that I held, including railway. So that bamboo will become an acceptable form of construction. We can construct houses as per this organized seminar. We can do many things. So when we got it approved, India became a member of International Network of Bamboo Ratan and Atal Bihari Vajpayee Cabinet. Then bamboo mission was set up, 4,000 crores was set up. And thanks to leadership of Prime Minister Vajpayee at that time and now Narendra Modi, at that time we organized an international conference in bamboo. And Prime Minister, then Prime Minister Vajpayee, he allotted a great role that I played into that, but it was all great leadership of Prime Minister then. Vajpayee and now Modi ji, which is actually making it your net. It can actually change the way many things are happening. Deforestation, of course. So all environment, ecology, employment, economy, all that will benefit for sure. But just imagine the massive possibilities of creativity that can play a role. I'll give an example. National Institute of Design helped us design a product which at that time we were using for mangoes in Konkan, where I was elected 4 times to Lok Sabha. We used to use only wood for that. So they designed a product which based on bamboo, which can now did not use wood at all. We actually worked on many areas, including the Forest Research Institute did a survey of Ratnagiri and Sindhudurga district to map about availability of bamboo and how that can be put to productive uses. Then, when CONBAC was formed in Konkan, and Mr. Karpe played a leading role into that, has actually helped community to link to this bamboo, which is now happening in Northeast also. Communities are getting linked. And a community participation is a so key to success of that. So I can see a huge potential to bamboo becoming a real miracle crop. It can help people to change their perspective. In any case, this is edible. Bamboo shoots are most edible in different parts of the world. So we can actually do food processing on that, can sell bamboo added edible product for use of so many different purposes. So this is all potential, but today you are discussing a very important aspect of it, that is building material. Now there is a new theme that you use the locally available material for construction. It has been our tradition. It has been tradition globally, but there is no just global trade of this kind. So while it has a possibility of entering global trade, as you mentioned, but it has also a possibility of being used locally for locally used construction material, whether it is in Northeast or in the Western Ghats and all other places where bamboo is available and plenty. And therefore, we can actually start working on developing construction material through bamboos and through another different kind of research and development. So I think all research organizations must join hands. University like Manipal University should play a key role. And then we can bring all the stakeholders together to transform our construction sector by using bamboo as an important construction material. But again, I will tell you that we should also use it for value-added products more. Can actually generate more income for the people. But of course, bamboo is available in such big quantity. The construction materials are definitely one of the very important applications of bamboo. So all the best to you. I had to go for some other events, but I didn't want to miss this opportunity of saying that for many reasons why I'm associated with this event, and therefore I really look forward to being part of this process of change, wherein bamboo will cause a trigger which people will start thinking differently, whether they're using for building material, for using for furniture, they're using it for fashion designing, for houses, many things. So I think all of you will use that. And thank you very much. Once again, congratulations. You are holding this event, the eve of World Environment Day, which falls tomorrow. I think that's the right thing to do, because World Environment will not be successful unless a day before that, we take a pledge to do such material will not cause deforestation. Mind you, deforestation is one of the major causes for climate change. So that's the land you change. Deforestation is the resulting of a deforestation. The carbon sinks go away. Therefore, you cannot absorb carbon into the system. But deforestation also causes loss of biodiversity, which may be one of the reasons why we are facing corona. Because when you lose biodiversity, the animals' habitat goes away. Therefore, animal diseases can enter the human body. So I think all of that resulted. So it's a very right time, right people. I can see such a distinguished group of people who are my co-panelists. I think they will add a lot of value more than me. Therefore, I really look forward to their participation and active deliberations. And let me promise you one thing. I will take forward your message and ensure that bamboo becomes a very acceptable form of day-to-day life, forget economy, ecology and others, a part of a day-to-day life, which has been, but now we should try to reinvent it, try to revisit it. So thank you very much. Congratulations to all my friends. I really look forward to working.
Thank you, sir, for writing and inspiring words on bamboo industry. And as you rightly said that we all stakeholders can come together and through community participation, we'll try to innovate on more on bamboo for different industries, like you had rightly mentioned, food processing, then construction material for product design. So we definitely will take this mission ahead, and we promise you that we all stakeholders will help to take this mission ahead. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you for giving your valuable time. Thank you. Now we will start with the presentation by experts, and I am pleased to introduce Mr. S.T.S. Lepcha, retired IFS officer. Mr. Lepcha is a member of National Level Executive Committee, National Bamboo Mission, Government of India. He was also Principal Chief Conservator of Forest in Uttarakhand. He has researched various bamboo and natural fiber related activities and helped in formulating the Government of India's natural fiber policy, which include nettle and hemp fiber for the first time in 2010. His major scientific technological achievements includes bamboo treatment with biopreservation techniques in Neem, tools and machine modification and development for bamboo and natural fiber processing. May I request Mr. Lepcha sir to start his presentation.
Thank you very much, Dr. Radha. Today I will speak on 5 points about bamboo, then about myths, and the two school of thought. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. You are audible. Yeah.
And where to focus, then suggestion. I have a 5 point to speak. So, see, about bamboo, everybody knows that bamboo is a giant grass. And on the left side, the bamboo is a grass, then the rhizome part is there. And basically, in the right side, the use of bamboo. So bamboo has more than 1,500 uses. See, this is the type of bamboo. Left side is monopodial bamboo. Left side is monopodial bamboo. And right.
Yeah.
See, the problem with bamboo is that why they call it a poor man's bamboo, because of the bamboo contain lots of carbohydrate. Because of carbohydrate, the insect will eat the sugary portion of the carbohydrate. Because of that, the life of bamboo is just 1 year if you not treat it very well. There are the various treatment method. The Sanjeev Karpe will tell you in detail. Traditionally, we do it leaching and smoking, but in generally practice in the housing sector, we do it vacuum processing and chemical treatment process. The detail will be explained by Karpeji. See, why bamboo? So ministers have already told that it is a sustainable material. And it's actually restore the soil, and even for watershed management, it retain 25% of moisture, water in the soil, and it is renewable. See, for a teak tree to grow, it will take 8 years, but bamboo is just 1 year. It will next year another bamboo will come. So it is sustainable material. So that is why we should go for this. So possibility. This is entirely my view. The myth in India is that, see, in the China, they call it friends of people. So they treated bamboo as a friend. In Vietnam, they call it brother of people. They treat bamboo as a brother. But other parts of world, including India, we treat bamboo as a poor man timber. That may be the cultural issue. I was posted in Bamboo and Fiber Development Board in 2003. Since then, it was very difficult to convince people in Uttarakhand the use of bamboo, because there is a taboo in India. Jo lagayega baans, uska hoga satyanash. So that taboo is there. The psychological problem is there. So we try to convince people, and we have constructed more than 90 bamboo housing, different gazebo, bridges, tourist cottage, all this thing. So initially we constructed small gazebo in Chief Secretary garden, so that the people will see the use of bamboo. Otherwise, they will think that bamboo is a bad thing, bad omen. Then slowly, we also constructed two gazebos and some outhouse for drivers in IS colony. So the people slowly they saw the value of bamboo and application of bamboo, and they think that it is not bad omen. So finally, this year the Uttarakhand government is thinking to build bamboo primary schools in hills of bamboo. So they are thinking to build at least initially 7. Then finally, they are thinking that I think they will go for 1,000 bamboo schools in future, because Uttarakhand, we have a zone 4 and zone 5 earthquake zone. So it's very dangerous. So it's better to build bamboo schools and all these things. So in spite of my effort in last 18 years, 20 years, now I am in policy making in Government of India. Even then, still people will ask, sir, bamboo se hoga nahi hoga kaam. So that is the myth. Still myths are there. So it's very difficult to go. So there is a live graveyard testing center in FRI Dehradun also. They have built bamboo structure as early as in 1950s. So that the structure is still good. So they are still testing. So that means the bamboo life is already 60 years in as per the FRI research. So it is no need to worry, but the people, the bamboos, I think bamboo is a, especially it is in our psychological psychological problem. Otherwise it is not a porcelain timber. It is more of a high value application, as Dr. Suresh Prabhu Sahib already told us. So initially, when we have started building a bamboo structure, there was a two view of thought. See, bamboo, we go for whole column bamboo, and others' view was that it should we should go for engineered bamboo. So because of some skill problems and the availability of bamboo engineering timber, so we thought that we go for whole column bamboo, because in whole column bamboo construction, the most of the wages are labor oriented. So the maximum self employment should be given in the whole column bamboo. The Sanjay Karpe will tell the details, so how much the money will go to the almost I think 70% of the cost is goes to the labor. So it is very good for rural employment. So I will show you some of the slide of whole column bamboo structure. The left hand side is I think Bali. So these are the structure, and for architecture you can play around. See, it's a very beautiful structure from whole column bamboo. You can bend, you can do it any design. So this is the famous bamboo structure in Colombia, made by Salmon Vales or something like that. He's Salmon Vales of Colombia. So one of the beautiful structure by whole column bamboo. See, I will go to engineering bamboo slowly. So this is the primary processing. Engineered bamboo, we have to cut it. We have to then we have to make sliver. Then from sliver we'll go to factory. Then they will treat it, and finally they will make the bamboo structure. So these are some of the engineering bamboo material. You can use it in making houses, laminated bamboo, strand woven bamboo, and so forth. So this is just like a lumber. Any skilled person of wood, they can convert it into housing material. So this is the process. From the forest, they will cut it, and they will take it to the factory, and the factory, then finally the end use is your house. These are the some applications, some of the application of engineered bamboo. On the right, left hand side is Beer's Save in Israel. So you can do combination of bamboo and steel also. So this is a staircase. And the right side, the Borg Nursery Home, Oslo. So it's a nursing home. See, indoor application also looks very beautiful. So DG Public Health, Public Works Office in Netherlands, and right-hand side is Akzo Nobel Center in Netherlands. So this is the famous Madrid International Airport engineer bamboo structure. See, in my view, now, where should we go? So as per the unavailability of this skill level and the cost effectiveness of the bamboo material, see, the cost of engineered bamboo is slightly high. So what my view is that, so as per our Indian condition, we should focus on earthquake-proof housing structure for schools, hospital, community halls initially. Then prefabricated post-disaster housing structure like for tsunamis, cyclone, and flood. And in the urban area, we should for the awareness creation and to change the mindset of the people. Slowly, we have to start with rooftop structure, fencing, internal paneling inside the office or house. So this is a focus point. And in horticulture, we can build big greenhouse structure, fruit and vegetable packaging, maybe FCI godown in the stores. And of course, ecotourism, the resort, the both permanent and temporary structure is already we are making. And this is my view. So what should we go next? So we all stakeholders like Architecture Association, Engineering Association, National Building Research Institute, Forest Research Institute, Green Building Association, HUDCO, Building Code, ETC. But there are so many stakeholders are there in construction of bamboo. So we have to should form one consortium. Then we have to think further. We have to take further it. Better for the bamboo, so that someday that poor man timber will become rich man timber. So that is my so any question I will answer you when there is answer question and answer session. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir, for elaborating different myths about bamboo due to cultural issues and giving us light on different school of thoughts related to bamboo. Now, I'll like to request the second panelist, and it's my privilege to introduce architect Sanjay Prakash. Sanjay Prakash is an architect with commitment to energy-conscious architecture, eco-friendly design, people's participation in planning, music and production design. Over the years, he has integrated all his work with the practice of new urbanism and sustainability in his professional and personal life. His area of practice and research over the last 34 years includes passive and low energy architecture and planning, hybrid air conditioning, autonomous energy and water systems, bamboo, wood and earth construction, community-based design of common property, and computer-aided design. Under his guidance, many people have developed capabilities in performing design, conceptual, or management of work in these areas. May I request architect Sanjay Prakash, sir, to start his presentation?
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Yadav. I'm a practicing architect, as Dr. Yadav has already introduced me. So I'm going to bring a practitioner's viewpoint, and if it doesn't look rosy, I shall try to be balanced in both the reasons why we don't adopt bamboo as well as the reasons why it should be adopted. So there are pros and cons to both sides, and that is what I will try and explain to the viewers. Let me just begin the presentation. So this is very well known, right? That the bamboo is traditionally called poor man's timber. And there are a number of reasons for this. One is that untreated, it has a very low life, but it's so low cost that the so-called, the apocryphal poor man easily uses it for making huts and lean-tos and so on. But clearly, a low lifespan basically makes it very difficult to adopt in the mainstream, because therefore it's considered a kaccha material, and it often has to be used with other kaccha materials, so called with reed, with thatch and so on. So that is another problem. So what we are talking about is engineered structural bamboo in this presentation, and I'll come to that. So this is what engineered bamboo is. Mr. Lepcha has already explained that it's a grass. This is a particular bamboo forest in Anji County, where I had gone to source bamboo for this is in China, where I had gone to source bamboo for a particular large structure that we were designing in China. I think its biggest property is that it's rapidly renewable. So what happens is that, unlike timber, which is slow to renew, this one is rapidly renewable. Now, one of the reasons why I believe we do not have too much of a bamboo culture of building formal buildings in this country is because we do not have a culture even of building in timber, except in certain parts of India. So wherever there is no culture of building in timber, it's very difficult to adapt to bamboo, because one of the properties of timber, which is its inflammability, needs to be dealt with in bamboo as well. And rapidly renewable it might be, but it has the disadvantage of timber as well as the advantages, of course. Bamboo has excellent root structure and it binds soil very well. So bamboo forests are well known to completely prevent soil erosion, and in that sense they're environmentally very beneficial. They are also considered, since they're very fast growing, I mean mature bamboo, even immature bamboo can grow as much as 2.5 feet in a day. So because it is so fast growing, it is supposed to sequester a lot of carbon in the form of carbohydrates. Now, the problem is that this is not an undisputed fact. So there are a number of researchers who have found that sequestration is higher in a new growing timber forest versus a bamboo forest and so on. So this is an area of research that remains to be settled. But it's true that it's not detrimental to the environment. Definitely does not cause mines like the mining of steel causes. Therefore, on the whole, I would say it's a good material to use. These are the structural properties of bamboo. Now, I've chosen from our Indian code IS 15912, I have chosen poor properties to compare with steel. You know, there's a common saying that bamboo is stronger than steel. This is not strictly true, because yes, it is stronger in tensile strength. You will see here in the bottom line. I don't know if my cursor can be seen. Can it? Yeah, okay. So this bottom line in this table gives you the ratio normalized for weight. So weight for weight, because bamboo is much lighter than steel, 8 or 9 times lighter. So weight for weight, you see that even though it has 25% of the tensile strength of steel, when you do it per unit weight, then it becomes 2.18 times. So it's much better. Shear strength likewise is good, but bending and compression are poor. Now, IS 15912 also says, and this is very interesting, that the practice to base designs on safe working stresses may be adopted to bamboo. This is the old style method of calculating the possible size of bamboo sections. So there is a limitation the traditional experience rather than precise calculations generally govern the detailing. Now, the reason for this is that these stresses are very highly variable, much more than timber. So timber might have a standard deviation of, let's say, in kilograms per centimeter square, something of 20 or 30. Bamboo can have much higher variations. I mean, I'm not going to be able to say newtons per millimeter square, but something of that kind. So, and what's more, its age matters, its species matters, the type of harvesting that was undertaken matters. So it is quite an art rather than a science. And this is one of the reasons why some of the largest agencies of construction in the country, say the CPWD, has been reluctant to take up bamboo, because it's not an industrial material and therefore its strength can vary from case to case. Bamboo has, as some of you would know, a hard siliconous outer skin, and that seems to be the place where a lot of its strength belongs. So you can't take it off, because if you take it off, the pith that's left inside is quite weak. Now, because it is siliconous and relatively impervious, it's difficult to treat bamboo. And yet it's very important to treat bamboo, because untreated bamboo has a life of 1 year, as was told earlier, while treated bamboo can have a variable life depending on the pressure, 25 years, 50 years and so on. And this on the right hand side is a view of the pressure treatment before pressure treatment is undertaken of a bamboo vat. So there are various kinds of materials used for treatment. For example, boric borax is a common one, and CCB, which is what is being used here, is another one. Bamboo and pests. Does bamboo have pests? Yes, surely it has borers. That's very well known. Eggs are in the bamboo shoots. Therefore, over a period of time, they will eat up the cellulose around and become larger, and they hatch and then they'll fly away. Well, in the worst case, if the borer infestation is very high, the bamboo might as well be given up for good. Does it have termites? Now, it is generally believed that bamboo does not have termites, but this is simply not true. Depending on the situation, depending on the species, bamboo can have termites. Treated bamboo, on the other hand, tends to have much less termites and much fewer borers. So there is again a case for treating. The problem, unfortunately, is that treatment nearly doubles the cost of bamboo, and that part doesn't go too much to labor. So, I mean, a lot of it goes into the material for treatment and the infrastructure. Even though 75% of the initial cost, I mean, we did an exercise recently of a 2-inch 13-foot long bamboo, which would cost 140 rupees when harvested, will about double in cost when it's treated. And the other comparison to this is that steel 40 mm equivalent and the same length with similar strength would cost considerably more. I mean, it would cost nearly 400 rupees for that one pole. And if GI treated, of course, it would cost the earth. It would become 2000 rupees. So that doesn't even count. What are the configurations in which we can use bamboo? So bamboo can be prefabricated and often is prefabricated. So it can be used to really reduce time on site. A lot of work can be done in the factory, like in steel. So you fabricate and you can erect, and therefore a kind of prefabrication mechanization can take place. In fact, if you have good booms and tower cranes, then the mechanization can make the construction really fast. The forms that bamboo can be turned into can be quite varied. For example, this is the dome of the Shanghai Pavilion, the pavilion, India Pavilion in Shanghai, that we made in 2010 during the World Expo. And this was made of bamboo, a little bit of steel, but mostly bamboo, and covered with an impervious extremely thin layer of ferrocement covered with these grasses that you see. This is the making of the dome. So you see that we are using one of the technologies that is very well known for large span, which is you grout cement into the joints. And maybe both pictures you will see that there are bolts being driven into the bamboo. But it is still an art to make bamboo structures, because you don't get exact shapes and sizes. You get a little bit of blowback when you try to bend bamboo under heat. And the carpenters here, which is what I'll call them, the carpenters, actually some of them have been given blow torches so that they can fire the bamboo and slightly curve it in order to fit. So on the right, you see the steel ring beam that was used to hold the structure together. And it was done in steel, not because it needed to be done in steel. It could have been done in bamboo, but it was done in steel because it is so much easier in China to fabricate it in steel that we simply decided to do it in steel. Now you can have therefore curved forms. This is a more or less a vaulted form, which is curved in plan, which we have done in Chandrapur in central India for Maharashtra PWD, because they have been the project managers for this, and that's a huge experience in itself. It can be straight. This example is from Vietnam, from a colleague of ours called Vo Truong Nha, who works exclusively in bamboo, a lot in bamboo. And another feature of the shapes that bamboo takes is that there is no definition left between columns and beams. They're actually often continuous, and that gives bamboo its characteristic curved shape. I show you all this because part of the reason why bamboo isn't used more and is considered a poor man's timber is because these kind of curved shapes have never been used. This is engineered bamboo and treated bamboo. As opposed to that, vernacular bamboo, of course, remains a poor man's timber and will tend to do that. I'm going backwards. And these are the forms in which bamboo can exist. You can use the bamboo whole. In this case, we use the entire bamboo as one. In fact, multiple bamboos have been put together and fused together so as to make a stiff enough beam, portal, and so on. You can use bamboo strip board. This is the flooring. So this is why I've taken this picture. The flooring was being load tested by 40 people standing on it. This is again in Chandrapur. And strip board flooring is a lot like timber flooring in the sense that it is a mortise and tenon joint, and these come in planks, so you can fit them together and so on. And it's definitely smoother than ply, and it's definitely more humidity resistant, and so it has great properties. This is becoming a big project, a big substitute for wood all over the world already. Foundations, though there exist bamboo foundations in the form of piles, such as the wooden piles that were put below the Taj Mahal when it was made, because it was a difficult site and it was on the edge of the Yamuna River. So even though piles can be used and bamboo can be driven in piles, it remains largely conventional because you don't want accelerated decay.
I think there was some problem with the connection of architect Sanjay Prakash. So can we start with the third presenter? We'll wait for him to solve the issue. I think we can continue for the presentation of Sanjay Prakash later on. So we'll start with the third presenter. I am pleased to introduce Mr. Sanjeev S. Karpe, an electrical engineer by training. Am I audible?
Yes.
Am I audible?
Yes.
I'm pleased to introduce Mr. Sanjeev S. Karpe, an electrical engineer by training. He is committed to positioning bamboo as the key resource for catalyzing a green economy and generating rural livelihoods in India. Kaprerna Fellow of IIM Lucknow. He has been associated with the bamboo industry for last 16 years. He is a pioneer in the field of manufacture of premium bamboo products in India. He has established a full-fledged ecosystem, including infrastructure and human resources, to build capacity of bamboo farmers and local artisans to grow the bamboo industry. He is the founder and managing director of Native Konbak Bamboo Products Private Limited, a Sankalp Award-winning social enterprise. May I request Mr. Sanjeev Karpe to start his presentation.
Thank you very much, Dr. Yadav. Thank you for giving me this opportunity. When we talk about bamboo, the first thing which normally comes to our mind is it's a poor man timber. But we need to understand that this is a very, very fast growing woody grass, fastest replenishing raw material on earth. Don't need a replanting. As you cut more, it will grow more. It will just multiply it using the same root system. And it has a fantastic capacity to sequester carbon dioxide. It can sequester up to 200 tons of carbon dioxide per year in just 1 hectare of a bamboo plantation. So this is the most important material for us. You can say this is an iconic material in sustainability, and we if we see how this material is used outside India, then you can I can show you images where multi-story building, aesthetically beautiful and durable structures made using completely bamboo in many part of the world except in India. So when we saw this and started thinking that why this eco-friendly material, why this icon of sustainability is not used in our country, even though we are the second largest bamboo producing country in the world. And when you see this type of structures, even stadiums done in bamboo with the huge spans in Colombia and good, nice looking bankway and a big auditoriums, we decided that now we need to think that why it is not easy used in India. If you see this international product trade chart, in top 10 exporter country of bamboo product, India's name is not there at all. Small country like Thailand, Singapore, Philippines, Indonesia is there, but India is not there. And India is there in a top importing bamboo product country, and that is a very bad situation. So in 2004, under the guidance of Honorable Suresh, we formed this organization and started doing some trials on bamboo. These are the Indian species, selected species. I'm showing you, first is Bambusa, first is Dendrocalamus toxi, second is Bambusa tulda, and third is Bambusa bambus. These are the three selected species in India which can be used for a structural purpose. There are many species, but right now I'm here talking about these selected species. Stoxi has a diameter of 40 to 50 mm. Tulda has a diameter of 50 to 70 mm and Bulko has a diameter of 70 to 100 mm. When you talk about grading of bamboo for a structural use, it needs to be graded as per the species, it needs to be graded as per the age, it needs to be graded as per the diameter. So age has to be between 3 to 6 years, diameter has to be minimum 45 mm, diameter at top, because bamboo is a tapering material, needs to be minimum 35 mm, length should be minimum, usable length should be minimum 4 meter, taper should not be more than 4 mm per meter length, and a bamboo should be fairly straight, and it should have wall thickness of minimum 10 mm. And if you do the proper age grading, then the question of treatability comes. So as per IS code 9096, bamboo can be treated by using a different methods. It can be treated by traditional method, it can be treated by chemical method. if you use a traditional method, you will not have much of the durability. But if you use a chemical preservative, yes, you will have a lot of life of bamboo. There are different type of preservative. Some preservative are water borne, some are oil based, organic solvent based, and natural toxicant. There are two type of preservative. One is non-fixing type. If you want to use bamboo under cover without getting in contact with the soil, then you can use a non-fixing type of preservative. And if you want to use bamboo in an exterior condition, in a contact with soil, then you need to use a fixing type of preservative. And CCB is one of the most famous wood preservative used even for treating bamboo. As per National Mission on Bamboo Application, Department of Science and Technology, if you pressure treat a bamboo will have minimum 50 years of a duration in an exterior condition and more than 100 years of a life in an interior condition. This is a pressure treatment plant where bamboo is treated in our premises at Kudal in Sindur district of Maharashtra. Bamboo needs to be straightened. Every time you will not get a straight bamboo, even though you segregate it. So bamboo needs to be straightened. And straightening bamboo is done like this, using very crude and traditional method of heating it and straightening. Straightened bamboo will look like just a pipe. Bamboo can be bent in a similar way, and it can be bent as good as you can bend a metal pipe. And once you have treated and graded bamboo, construction, modern construction is very easy, because then you have now properly treated bamboo which will last long, and graded bamboo with all the needed specification. Initially, we started with very simple product, landscapes element, keeping in mind that the elements which we'll do needs to be aesthetically beautiful and durable. Slowly trying to convince people to use bamboo for construction of cottages. Tourism industry definitely is ready to accept this, because they find value for money for this type of product, which is in cost, which is higher than normal cement concrete structure. So we started getting good response to this type of structures, where the different type of cottages in different part of country we did, and slowly getting good acceptability from a tourism industry for this type of cottages. Then we thought that now we need to attempt for doing a bigger building with bamboo in India, just like what you see outside India. So we started prefabricating components in our factory. And after that, you really need to know about what are the state properties, because bamboo is a bioresource. No structural engineer will take a responsibility and certify the structural stability of a structure. So if you do 1:1 size one bay and test it, then it will be easier for a structural engineer to certify that stability of that building. So we did that also, and then this type of component is packed and sent through bigger trailer on site, and this is the actual erection on site. So this gives us a needed confidence, and then we got a chance to construct largest building in the country 3 years back at Hyderabad for a builder called Organo. This is a clubhouse for one eco-friendly villa project with a 64 feet of a span. Complete roof is done in bamboo, and this gives confidence to the client that yes, with Indian bamboo you can really do bigger structure also. This is the project for Bamboo Research and Training Center, Forest Department, Chandrapur, which is designed by Sanjay Prakash ji, and we are doing construction for this project. Most of the construction is over. This is around 1 lakh square feet of a bamboo structure built by us in Chandrapur for a forest department through PWD. So when you work for a PWD, there has to be a proper code, there has to be proper testing mechanism, and all these challenges has been taken care, and now this project is nearly completed, and I'm very sure now that other states can also follow and have this type of a bamboo building in their state also. After this, the major question about the cost, everybody started wondering whether this cost is really competitive or not. So we decided to compete with the foreigner companies outside India. Waldorf Austria, which is one of the top high-end brand of Hilton, is setting up a resort in Itafushi, Maldives. We bid for the restaurant in bamboo, which they floated the tender. Luckily, we got it. All bamboos are bent in our factory in Kudal. We have done prototyping in our factory, and this is a work actually on site. And this project is completed 1.5 years back. So this particular project has been rated as world's top 16 best waterfront restaurant by CNN UK. So this gives us confidence that yes, this Indian bamboo and Indian manpower technology is globally competitive. We can beat even China in price and quality outside India also. And that gives us a confidence that yes, India can do it. The only problem here is this is not scalable, because this work is done in a craft mode type of, even this is a engineered building, this is a craft type of work. So no, you just cannot scale it up to after a certain level. So we thought that now we need to do bamboo construction just like a pre-engineered metal building. So we got a chance to try that for a Raja Rajeshwari Temple Trust in Karnataka. This is a banquet which is proposed for 500 people sitting capacity near Gadak in Hulkoti. And in that project, we decided to have completely pre-engineered building. This work is right now going on. Most of the work is completed, and you will see that this is the project with 24 meter of a span and around 50 feet of a height. This is done just like any other pre-engineered metal building. So this gave us a confidence that if you do bamboo construction like this, this particular technology can be really scalable and replicable, and this will give confidence that yes, the bamboo can be a mainstream material. There was a poor man's timber image issue, and everybody is wonder that why people will pay more, because this structure has this material has the image of poor man's timber. Now we are fortunate enough that Bangalore International Airport phase 2 is coming up, and the terminal building which is being done by a American company and designed by also American architect is having completely bamboo interior. I am very, very sure after completion of this project, this is 12,30,000 square feet of a bamboo structures with complete interior. This is going to change image of bamboo from poor man's to rich man's privilege, and we should be now prepared to really take this opportunity and start using this material in a day-to-day life as well as for a construction. Many people has many questions about this material. I would like to tell all of them that please start using this material
and be a part, be a drop in the ocean, so that we can really take this material forward. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Karpe, for such a wonderful presentation and throwing light on various aspects of bamboo, treatment of bamboo, structural strength of bamboo, and how even cost effectiveness, and how bamboo can be used from small scale typology to large scale typologies in architecture. So now I think, and boosting our confidence also, and I am confident that people must have listened to you, and their confidence also must have increased for bamboo. Thank you for such a wonderful presentation. Now I think we'll continue with the presentation of Sanjay sir. He's back here.
Okay. Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Okay, now I want to just know, where was I when I was bumped out by my Wi-Fi? I was just showing the building of Chandrapur. Okay.
Yes.
Was it this one? Just a minute.
You were explaining about foundation.
Oh, I was explaining about foundation. Okay.
Yeah.
So then I will go on further. Okay.
Yes.
So the next thing I wanted to show you was that bamboo mats, which are better than timber plies because they are smoother, more water resistant, and if we want, they can be longer lived, definitely can make very good walls. And when we come to roofs, we can make them either out of like this, which are bamboo shingles, which is bamboo culms, which are flattened out and beaten to make wood like shingles, or more traditionally in Southeast Asia, this kind of an inclined roof, which is a corrugated type of inclined roof made by half bamboos, A, B, B, A, B, and so they can carry the water down in a slope. I wanted to put in some elements of what R&D requires to be done to make bamboo much more mainstream. And clearly the first thing that comes up is fire resistance. Here is a situation where fire resistance is being tested in Chandrapur by our team. The National Building Code requires 2 hours for a full proper pakka building definition, while bamboo typically has a 45 minute kind of resistance, which is as good as steel or better than steel, but not really as good as concrete. So there is this little limitation that needs to be overcome. I believe CBRI Roorkee is working on it, and we should get a bamboo fire code soon. For the time being, we don't really have one. The other issue that we faced in Chandrapur especially was the element of cracks. So we realized, working with the Maharashtra PWD, that when their engineers asked, do we have a manual for how much cracks we can accept and how much we can't, the fact is we don't. So we had to accept them on a case by case basis. Is this member going to take longitudinal tension, in which case the crack can be tolerated? If it's going to take compression, then the buckling has to be seen. If it is taking bending, then it has to be rejected and replaced, and so on. So, and exactly what length of crack it is, how wide it is. This is a good, very bad example I'm showing you in this picture, but clearly there are simply some surface cracks and there are some deeper cracks. So that area requires also a lot of research, because you need codification for how much cracking is acceptable. And this is all to do with multiple species of bamboos having different properties, and that becomes the primary problem in handling bamboo. This is a picture from China, where we were bending the Mosho bamboo culms into a curve for the large dome. But brittleness is another problem which requires a lot of research. The Young's modulus of bamboo is less than 10% of steel, and its elastic range is very small. So what happens is that it shows plastic behavior. We discovered this while trying to bend this bamboo. It had a spring back, as the tables on the left show. The 9.7 mm deflection becomes 9 after a while, after removing load. So the springing back is not an acceptable property for structural engineers, and therefore we had to work within elastic limits, and therefore we increased our cost a lot. Now, therefore, natural variability itself is an area which is ripe for research. Now, I'm mentioning all this because these are the reasons why we do not use bamboo, and I don't intend to be negative, but actually very positive that these are the areas where some of you youngsters especially could find a whole field of research which is ripe for getting a variety of degrees, PWD, PhDs and so on and so forth. And lastly, I must say joints require a lot of work, because while we know quite a bit about bamboo culms and sticks, we don't know too much about joints and how they behave. So there are various kinds of joints which are illustrated here, and the behavior of this, even though IIT Bombay is trying out some tests, it has not yet been codified. So this was the scene very often in Chandrapur in our office when we were doing physical model and so on, to be able to gauge what worked and what did not work. While this is the kind of jig that you can say almost like a jugaad, which is testing for individual pieces and how much they are deflecting. This is a slightly more professional jugaad, which is made in Kudal, that is Sanjeev Karpe's factory. And you can know this is, I think, in Chandrapur itself. And you hang various loads at various points to see the deflection and the spring back, and then decide whether you can accept it or not. So these are all examples both of why bamboo is a great material as well as for why it is not widely accepted. Now let me quickly go through some global examples. Vietnam, where the main architect there is Vo Trong Nha, whose structure I showed you before, uses a certain slender kind of bamboo, and he uses many multiple culms strung together. He even designs the structure in a way that, because when bamboo deteriorates, he designs them in a way that individual bamboos can be replaced, because you see the building is not taking all the load all the time. So you can choose in a group of say 30 to take out one or two bamboos and replace them. So he does it this way, and the characteristic dark color comes from the treatment of Vietnamese bamboo. This is another structure by him. You can see it's great architectural forms, and it's really structures like this that can change the perception of bamboo from poor man's timber to a more acceptable, stylish material. Simon Velez, who by the way helped us in Shanghai, is a genial old gentleman from Colombia. He's an architect, and along with a few engineers, he has managed to practically invent from scratch the large diameter bamboos that they have in South America to create such large structures, this being an exhibition gallery, this being a bridge, and this being a church actually, which is quite amazing that he manages such large spans. And therefore we had used him in Shanghai to help train our people to design the 35 meter dome that we had there. So this is that dome, and you see the completed structure with the flags of China and India flying in the expo. You also see the large number of crowds that are there. And this is the Chandrapur project. This is the one of the office blocks. You see the Chandrapur project now made is complete whole bamboos, as well as in this case cement floor, because on the ground floor, but upper floors are bamboo strip boards. And the walls you may see here are made of rammed earth. So rammed earth, like bamboo, is another material that requires codification, and it has only been partly codified during the Gujarat earthquake, where Punarshala was instrumental in codifying it, because it's a common technique in Gujarat and in Bhuj especially. The other area which requires a lot of this work is Ladakh, where a lot of crammed earth is used. This is a view of the upper floor, which you see how the board floor looks on the first floor. So that's it. Thank you very much. And I'm sorry that I had to do it in two parts, but I hope this time at least I was heard throughout. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for such a superb presentation, and it was very comprehensive, as you have covered all the practitioners' view for bamboo and touched and briefed us about the new research areas of bamboo. And definitely we have to join together to take this research ahead, and we will do something in this area, sir. Now I am pleased to introduce architect Sankalp. He is assistant professor in Faculty of Architecture, SEPT University. He is one of the founding members of Thumb Impressions Collaborative, a collective that is involved in artisan-based construction initiatives and has rich experience in designing and building with materials like earth, bamboo, timber, and steel. He has been actively involved since the last 7 years working on detailing in bamboo for buildings. He has conducted several workshops at national level related to bamboo for students. His current focus lies on use of split bamboo as a construction material in Indian context. May I request architect Sankalp to start his presentation.
Is my screen visible?
Yes.
And the full screen now?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am, for inviting me. It's wonderful today that after around 8 or 9 years, I'm sharing a platform with Mr. STS Lepcha as well as Mr. Sanjeev Karpe. Both of them were one of the first people with whom I sort of started my career in bamboo. I did my first workshop in bamboo with Uttarakhand Bamboo Board, and that time he started with a workshop with, I think, Jeffrey Duzo and Ripal. So I'm quite happy to sort of share this platform. My focus in bamboo would be rather very at a very small scale rather than at a large scale. So let me start by saying that having selected a suitable bamboo in India, rather than getting into what is the way in which we can select a suitable bamboo, because that also is a whole process that we can get into it. We all know that Balcoa, Stoxi, Nutan, Strictus, Tulda are some of the important species which are used in sort of construction, in structural or other secondary member purposes. My presentation will deal with four important questions. What are the ways in which architecture has dealt with detailing in bamboo? What is the relationship between geometrical characteristics of bamboo, which is its morphological characteristics, to its detailing in architecture? How are physical and mechanical property of bamboo related to its detailing? I'll be slightly brief because already Sanjay sir has covered that. And what are the future tasks and prospects in India related to bamboo in architecture? So what are the ways in which architecture has dealt with detailing in bamboo? So if you look at across the world, we will see these kinds of example by Simon Welles. And so if you observe very carefully, you will see that there is certain degree of a fastness which has been customized to take care of almost being a universal joint. If you look at both wrong structures, then you'll find that some way there is a lashing, but also there is bundling, and that same structure from outside, but you'll also see the roofing is thatch. One structure from Darjeeling and the second one from Germany, if I'm not wrong, or China. And so if you look at this structure, then you will see the difference between the structural member and the enclosure system. So, and then you get to Rudrapur, where you will see lashing and bundling in a larger way. So, then again, same Rudrapur, but if you look at from inside, you will see the way the bundling happens. So it's in the deeper. So the bamboo is used as a beam, and so almost the depth is increased by bundling it. And if you look at these details, you'll find that these are customized fasteners, but there are also intelligence in developing a universal joint by Simon Vallis. And here you will find that that structure in Green School, where you'll find that the joints are, they are bundled, but at the same time the joints are customized fish mouth joints. Back in India, you'll find that under native kerpe, native conback kerpeser under his leadership, you will find that these kinds of structure, though now we find much more bigger structure that has come up. So one of the thing which is critical to understanding bamboo, and I put it in context of India, is that generally by documenting, what I found out is that 1.5 is an approximate grade for structural purpose, which means a single bamboo with a single bamboo vertical and horizontal, if you sort of make a structure out of it, then 1.5 meter grade is a good one. If you increase that, in course of time, the structure will start bending, and that you will be able to see in sort of 1 or 2 years, which means that the moment the span increases, there has to be some compensatory action that has to be done in order to work with the bamboo in India. Now, we also know that it is eventually the structural system that we have to understand to sort of take care of the span. And sort of all material properties almost gets inbuilt into the manner in which loads get transferred. So generally in case of bamboo, one has been working with pure compression members. Second, one has been working with trusses, which are members which distributes load through pure tension and compression. And then you have got bending, in which you have to increase the depth of the section. And there has been some composite, but lastly, these are three ways in which one has worked. Of course, to some extent, one can think about also surface structure if one is using split in a particular way. What is the relationship between morphology and its detailing in architecture? So if we look at bamboo, we find various shape and sizes. So this is from Forest Research Institute in Dehradun. The other characteristics of the bamboo you will find is that in case of India, we will not find very straight bamboo. So bamboos are generally bent. And if naturally it is bent, it means one direction the fibers are more stronger in tension, another direction it would be better in compression. So, I mean, likewise, what one used to grade timber in terms of trying to mark compression and tension while cutting it, but in case of bamboo, it becomes slightly easier because it's a single piece. Now, generally bamboos are used hollow, solid and split, so various kinds of split sections can be worked out. Now, if you look at the solid or the hollow bamboos, then these are the four factors which we have to look at it while which has a consequence on construction. One is the variable diameter from top to bottom. The second is non-uniform circular section, which means wherever we will cut the bamboo, we cannot assume that it is a perfect circle. Third is shrinkage and sort of splitting, which is depending on species, moisture, and some other studies which still needs to be carried out, because the research still has not been adequate as far as what I have gone into. And the fourth factor is the straightness. So these are the four things which one needs to know while detailing a sort of a bamboo. So when we are talking about variable diameter from top to bottom, then there are issues of line and levels in construction, and there are issues of connecting between two poles in widening joints. So I'll explain you quickly. So if you assume this bamboo, and I'm assuming it almost like a straight pipe, and it is fixed on two points, and you'll find that there is a center line there. But in reality, the bamboo is not a perfect cylinder, and it is a conical, which means that there is a variation in level from one point to another point. So once So the point is, if there is a variation in levels, then while constructing, one has to know how to take care of the lines and levels. So at one point of time, in case of bamboo, one is always working with the line, but at another point of time, because two members are coming one over the another, there are scopes of differences in level, and that tolerances need to be built up while detailing itself. Now, if we consider widening joint, then if two bamboos are put together, either top bottom or bottom top, you will find most of the time there would be a gap, unless until there is a enough amount of grading and sorting done in the bamboo. And these are real challenges, because our aesthetic taste has developed about based on either timber which has got uniform section or industrial which also has got uniform section, whereas there needs to be slightly different orientation while working with bamboo. Now, as far as non-uniform circular sections are concerned, we know that, let's say, if we have to connect two different bamboos having connecting through a lending joint, then the first problem that comes is that whether the point at which both of them are connected have got the same diameter or not, they have got the same absolute circle or whatever precise geometry that they want to connect or not. Otherwise, you will find that there is some kind of a gap which either you have to accept it as a aberration or as a aesthetic choice, or you select a bamboo in the manner that you see that uniformity. So there is some possibility of articulation, which is important to be aware about. And then there are issues related to connection between bamboos which are intersecting at perpendicularly or at certain angles. So the same thing I've explained through diagram is that now two different dias of bamboo coming together. Now how do you make a lending joint unless and until you have really sorted a bamboo in a way that two bamboos come together and they have got the same dia. But there are other creative ways to resolve it, which I'll not get into right now. Then if it is connecting at let's say at an angle or at perpendicular, the question always comes at the meeting point, what are the different diameters? Because now if you look at it, there are two extreme ways in which it has been worked out. One way is either you make a fist mouth joint which you have to customize. The second way is what like Simon Waller's example was there, where there is a universal connector between the two bamboos. So which means there is a mediating detail which works between the two bamboos when the connection happens. And of course, the third is a simple way, you just crisscross it. And therefore, you do not fight with the property of the bamboo in terms of its variability in that sense. And that's what has been shown here. So struggle for detailing is to detail with questions of standard fasteners for a variable diameter and shape of bamboo. That's number one. Flexible fasteners to adapt to varying size and shape, which is lashing. Third, developing details using standard fasteners in a way that it evades the variation in diameter and shape. So you see, the first example is where standard fasteners for variable diameter and shape of the bamboo is already there. Which is in the middle example. I'm sorry, that image is in the center, which is an example which Simon Wallace details. And then flexible fastener means that the lashing is used, which is in the first image. And the third one is customization, which you will find on the right side. Now, all of these are based on assumption that do we want to assume it to be a straight line, or do we want to assume it to be of the same diameter? And these are some larger things within which it works. So if we have to deal with all of these, there are two important things which we have to work on site with. One is sorting and grading of the bamboo, which means that once we have selected a species, we sort of say that there is a 12 or 14 feet or 15 feet of usable length of the bamboo, and the variation in diameter is less, then you sort of further start sorting it into terms of where in that length is the center of gravity. Because if the center of gravity, in case of timber, the variation in center of gravity is very less in a particular length L, but when it comes to bamboo, because there is, across the length there is a variation in density, which means there is a lot of difference in terms of positioning of CG in that length. And therefore, based on what we have worked out, these variations could go as high as 45 to 60 centimeter, whereas in case of timber it is 1-3 centimeter, and in case of steel it is almost nothing. So I'm just giving you images of some of the standard details which generally are worked out. This sort of here are some experiments which our organization had done with Rhizome, and so it is put up here. Now, other key challenges of detailing is something like this. Now, because bamboo is a linear fiber, unlike timber, so what you have to do is notice the corner condition, the blue dotted line which I have put in. Now, if you look at that point, if it was timber, then the members the beams that were coming from both the direction would be at the same level. But when it comes to bamboo, the question is, most of the time the difficulty starts happening because we cannot do a lap joint in bamboo, unlike in timber. What it means is that if we'll have to retain the strength of the bamboo, you will have to either align it through some other ways, or we'll have to put one bamboo over the other. Now, when we put one bamboo over the other, the difficulty is the level difference between the two sides, especially in four-sided roof. Now, there are ways to deal with it, which I'll not discuss that. So that is what we need to understand, that the detailing in bamboo is not same as detailing in timber or detailing it in steel. So, but at the same time, overall, we have to understand, follow the center line, but do not forget to take cognizance of variation in bamboo sizes. Now, regarding shrinkage and splitting, there are 3-4 key points. A lot of study needs to be done in that. The thing is, one, that overall weakening of bamboo pole and eventually failure happens when there is a shrinkage, but as Sanjay sir was pointing out, it depends on how much you can tolerate, in which direction, depending on what forces will work, that you can accept certain kinds of splitting. Second is critical while drilling the bamboo pole. So while drilling it, it is important that it shouldn't be drilled by an impact. It should be drilled slowly so that the material is removed, because if it is drilled by impact, then there are chances it will split. The third point is that there has to be awareness about how much torque needs to be put while securing a nut and bolt, because if you'll do over, it will again result into splitting. And the third is study of various species to register shrinkage and splitting tendencies while applying in construction, and a lot of work needs to be done in this area. So these are just an image to sort of put it. On the left side, if you see bottom portion, that's what it is. It's a detail by Simon Wellage. Now, one of the interesting thing about the detail is, if you look at the washer. Now, the idea is that when we tighten it, there is a tendency to split because the bamboo is sort of pushed. The fibers are pushed, and therefore, if you look at the saddle shape of this member, will sort of do a reverse action and therefore try to secure the fibers in the other direction. So it's quite an intelligent detailing in a way. Now, straightness, we have to so either we accept that whatever we get, we work with it, but it has to be within a limit of certain kinds of bend, or we have to straighten the bamboo to work with it. Again, there are positions about it as to why do you want to straighten it, or why don't we can work with both the position. It depends on how do we want to detail about it. So these are some of the ways in which straightening happens. I'll just touch on similar is the split, but I'll just touch on one part of it. So you can get splits from all these ways, A, B, C, D, E, F, from the sections. Now, the important thing is, when you get the split, the size, the section size of the split at the bottom is not the section size of the split at the top. Also it is same that the center of gravity is not its geometrical center. Now, what it means is that if we have to work with uniform section, we will have to remove material from the bottom portion in order to get the same section both the sides, which means at the bottom side there are few fibers which we have to remove it. So we should be aware about its replication when we are trying to detail out. And these are some of the examples what we can work out in split bamboos. This is an R&D which with my students I have been trying to take in sort of anti-clastic forms. in tensile structures, etc., and trying to work with details in a way that it we can further develop industrial fasteners, so that you get the split, you just fix it and develop a tensile structure. So that is the level and some of the other articulations which we have been working on. However, physical and mechanical property of bamboo related to its detailing, I will not get into detail, but there are important things which we have to understand. One is the average moisture content, and some says 15%, some says 18%, some says 12%. But why we say average moisture content? Because every single bamboo is different. I'll not get into mechanical property because Sanjay sir has explained in detail. I'll just say that you will find that most of the time in examples, many of the detailing has been worked out because of by bundling it. And one of the reason is that bamboo has low modulus of elasticity, and you compensate that by bundling. Now, what are the future tasks and prospects in India related to bamboo in architecture? Before that, we have to know that what has been happening in India related to bamboo in architecture. So I'll quickly show you example. These are typical example we use, abuse. We do all kinds of things with bamboo. These are typical house forms we work out with bamboo. These are typical a sort of exo view of a four-sided roof worked out in bamboo. And these are some of the architects that have been working in the area of bamboo in India. So architect Neelam Manjunath, Conback, Wondergrass, Bijoy in Thumb Impressions, where Bijoy Studio Mumbai, and we were a bamboo consultant for this Melbourne Pavilion. Then we have been also doing small and little bit work, but we are largely trying to explore detailing. Now again, one of the thing which I have been careful about is that that material properties and the use has to go in sync with what we do. So many of times, let's say corner conditions, we have not been using bamboo, rather we use timber, but we use bamboo in careful way. Sometimes we don't use bamboo in vertical member outside, we use generally inside, but especially for roofing, I think personally I have documented bamboo roofs which has been just done out of traditional treatment which is 50 years old. These are some of the work which we did for Kochi Mudris Biennale as a bamboo consultant. We have been always trying every project trying to articulate in some or the other ways. There are new projects where now the spans have increased and we have started working out. So this is a yogshala which we are working, bending bamboo, etc. But we are only using it for spanning member, and for bearing member we are not using bamboo in that case. So what are the future tasks and prospects? I think one of them is the supply chain of bamboo. Because to give you an example, now this is an example of China. It's a website you can go. It says clearly straightened bamboo, how much you want. I mean, so the thing is, the market chain is already built up for architects, because see, one cannot work all the time like the way Conback has been working right from bottom to the top. Now it's not all the time possible to work at all the levels, and especially coming from design fraternity, it is important that if the raw material chains are proper, then many people in today's time and many young people are eager to take bamboo. That's what I have been at least seeing it. Then detailing that can easily replace bamboo. So we have been always working with detail that it is not permanent. If there is some problem, you replace it. Then prospects of split bamboo. Now look, one of the things which we have been seeing is that many of our bamboo species are not straight. What do we do with it? So one of the thing is, if we start working with split bamboo, then we can have uniform section of the bamboo, and perhaps more work is possible when we start using split bamboo. Then there is universal joinery, and I think Simon Wallace was a very good example where he was able to do that. Then replacement of physical test to code. So as Sanjay sir was saying, and that's true, that all the time on site we are doing tests so that we figure out whether it will work or not, because ultimately an engineer has to also look at their calculation and sort of do their job so that the structure stands. Then fire resistance, he has already talked about it. Appropriate use based on material property. I have been saying this all the time that that to give an extreme example, we should not make toilet pan and everything out of bamboo, because then what it ends up doing is that if there has been any kind of a gap in design, then it is the material that suffers because of the cultural connotation of being poor man's material. We need constant artisanal upgradation and employment creation of job, which means that that not all the architect needs to make 100% bamboo. Sometimes there are small ways in which one would be able to use bamboo, some in interiors, some in partition, some in other things. So what happens is that in smaller and bigger ways in construction industry, when we start using bamboo, then we will also start giving job opportunity to a level which is required, because unlike carpenters, the bamboo artisans get less paid, that we all know. Then readiness of aesthetics in bamboo. The other thing is that one of the good things that has happened is that some of the work, especially work of CONBAC and work of other organization, the level of finish is of a kind that sort of creates a different kind of a clientele, which is absolutely required, because it shows that at what level we can really work with bamboo. Now the other thing is roofing structures, shading devices, partition wall, mixed use of material. So these are the other things we can do. So some of the R&D which we have been doing is sort of trying to create various tetrahedra, and it started with one of my students who got influenced by many of the furniture designers, and then we started further working on all this. How do we articulate bamboos? How do we create the end condition details in split? And then one of the way to do is always to do a student workshop and try and every time do a different R&D. So every time we are doing it, we are trying to experiment with students and try to do something, because at least we get some resource to do it. We were also trying with Hunarshala to work on bamboo formwork for Ramdard. And these are some of the experiments which we have been doing, articulating with students. Recent work has been with tensile structures, where with students at SEPT, we have been working with both the soap bubble experiment as well as scripting on sort of a grasshopper to generate various grids, and then try and sort of develop, make 1:1, and then further develop details. And the purpose of this is slowly we start making details as a universal joint. And so what it does is that in the market then, or in other places, it can be launched where people have split bamboo of certain sizes and they can just fix it and erect it. So these kind of work, which has been my interest, I'm very thankful to artisans and to all other people with whom I have spent time and learned. Thank you.
Thank you, Architect Sankalp, for such a beautiful presentation. And I hope you have all the aspects, especially from design point of view. And you have rightly said, and given this 10-point task, and which I believe we all can together, we should address this future task, like institutions, industry experts, practitioners, and the researchers also. Definitely we can address your future task of 10-point agenda. And thank you very much for such a comprehensive presentation. Now we would like to take questions and answers. There were 342 questions, but out of that 342 questions, we have shortlisted around 15 to 16 questions. So I'll just read the questions and then we can decide. This question is for Sankalp from Pankaj. He is a professional practitioner. How to increase bamboo bonding compatibility with concrete? This is for Architect Sankalp. How to increase bamboo bonding compatibility with concrete?
I don't think that I have worked in this area, especially bamboo and concrete. And maybe Sanjay sir has worked, he would be able to better address to my, so I can only address by saying that some experiment we have done with using split as reinforcement. Now the only thing is that we have to So apart from splitting, etc., one of the things we have to take care is that being an organic material, it absorbs moisture. So the thing is, first, if we have to use it, we'll have to coat it with some material so that it is a water repellent, so that there is a better way in which curing can happen in concrete. That is one. Second is that we have to also look at, because bamboo is smooth, it requires certain kinds of roughness to be able to develop bonding between split and concrete. So some work needs to be done on that part. But I'm sure, I know that many engineering departments have been working on this. But if somebody else wants to respond on that further.
Yes, I think Mr. Sanjeev Karpe, you want to reply? And Sanjay Prakash sir also.
So Sanjay Prakash, you should let him reply first.
Yes.
Okay, let me share some experience. No, I have also not worked with concrete and bamboo as a composite. But when I started my practice in the 1980s, I remember there were some trials in CPRI Roorkee for replacing steel in concrete with bamboo. And I guess they were commonsensical trials, and I don't think they were too successful. And if at all they were successful, I think they were trying to use the fact that bamboo has very good tensile properties for its weight, and therefore were trying to see if they could replace steel. It would have been a big news by now if that had succeeded very well. But on the whole, I don't think there is a huge progress in that area. Now, the importance of that area, however, is that given the fact that we are generally, we favor concrete for most of our buildings, this would have been a very easy entry point for bamboo had it succeeded. But it seems to me that it was only small lintels and small roof panels, you know, just 1 meter by 1 meter or something, that were made and were tested to failure, and it wasn't very attractive. So, but that's my opinion, but I don't have direct experience of having worked on this.
So as Sankalp ji said, that if you want to put a bamboo into concrete, it has to be a completely water repellent. And to make a bamboo completely water repellent, there is a treatment method available which is called as a hot and cold creosote method. If you use that method, you will make bamboo completely water repellent, and then that bamboo can be definitely used in concrete as a reinforcement. But the cost of bamboo will go up like anything, and then it will be more in cost than a normal steel bar. Okay, world's largest cement company Lafarge is doing a research in replacing bamboo with steel in concrete for last around 4 to 5 years. The research has been done in 4 different countries, not in India, but 4 different countries, including Singapore and Vietnam. I met a Lafarge guy 3 months back, and he told me that they have already spent 2,800 crore rupees on this R&D and not successful yet. So they said that we are successful, but the cost of that material is so high, so that cannot be used. So let them make a necessary R&D first, and then we will definitely use it. Right now, using bamboo which is not water repellent in concrete is not a very good idea. Thank you.
Okay, sir. Thank you. We'll move to next question. This is again for Mr. Karpe from Kunjan Choradia. She's a student. How do we increase fire retention time of bamboo structures?
So now I think with the detail given by Sanjay Prakash ji, we have 45 minutes of retardancy. If you want more retardancy, then coatings are available. Even IS code, which talks about bamboo as a structural members, gives you detail how you can make bamboo more fire retardant. So if you follow that code, that is sufficient, but you will not get 2 hours of retardancy. Now you should be happy
with around 1 year of our hours of retardancy. Thank you.
The next question is for architect Sanjay Prakash. And the question is that, apart from bamboo mats and boards, what are the explorations in prefab bamboo elements to support the prevalent do-it-yourself culture of subsistence housing?
Now, you see, whenever we talk of multi-story construction, so far, barring maybe two stories, bamboo has not really been used in multi-story construction. And the primary reason for that is that once you are up there in the sky, I think two or three floors above, then you need to really be careful about how you can run out in case of fire. And that becomes a constraint, but I'm not saying it can't be done. In fact, IIT Delhi Civil Engineering Department is working on the possibility of making three and four story structures. The Canadian code allows timber buildings up to six stories, provided they are fire coated, and therefore it's only a small step from a Canadian code with a six story building allowed in timber to jump to bamboo and so on. So there are all kinds of issues related to this, but primary amongst them is the fact that it's not even cost effective to do this. So you can engineer bamboo, it becomes expensive, but still competitive with steel. And then if you over-engineer it, it will become truly expensive. So after a point, it will become unnecessary, because one of the reasons is that even if it doesn't have to be a poor man's timber, it can't be so expensive that even a rich man can't afford it.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Now, next question is from Vijay Kadam, who is a professional practitioner. And this is for Mr. Lepcha. How is bamboo farming profitable to farmers? Can you hear me, sir? This question is for Mr. Lepcha. How is bamboo farming profitable to farmers? Okay. I think he is having some technical problems.
Should I answer that?
Address, yes.
Yeah, so when we started our activity, Convex activity in Sindhur district, the big question in front of us in 2004 is Sindhur district farmer has option of growing Alfonso mango, growing cashew nut, growing coconut, and we want to convince our farmers to do farming of bamboo, which is very, very difficult, but we could able to do that. And after now 16 years, you have more than 10,000 farmers in Sindhur who are doing proper farming of bamboo. So it clearly shows that doing bamboo farming is more beneficial compared to even Alfonso mango or cashew nut. And if bamboo can beat Alfonso mango and cashew nut, I'm very sure it can beat any other agriculture crop in our country.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Lepcha, this is question for you, same question. How is bamboo farming profitable to farmers? Sir, you are muted, I think. You can unmute. I think, okay, we'll take another question then. There is a question from Mugdha, who is a professional practitioner. And this question is for architect Sanjay Prakash. How can we upscale use of bamboo and ensure its acceptability in market amongst users?
I think this has been covered quite extensively in the various presentations that were made today. And also the barriers to upscaling have been discussed by all the speakers. And since this question was probably asked before this seminar took place, I think I can safely assume that this doesn't need to be answered directly anymore.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much. The next question is by Sanjay Sonar, who is a professional practitioner. Can we use, this is for architect Sankalp. Can we use bamboo in road construction?
I don't know. I don't know. I've never heard of, I don't know, has Sankalp and Sanjeev, have you any experience with this matter? No, I don't think so.
For retaining walls,
for, yes. As a filler?
As a bamboo, as a road construction, this type of work has been done by our engineer Vilas Goreji. He is from Mumbai. He has used bamboo in road construction about 10 years back. This is a patch between Pune and Mumbai of 8 kilometers worth that has been done by engineer Vilas Goreji, and this is quite successful as per his claim. So yes, there is a possibility, but don't expect to save money using bamboo. No, if you expect to have sasta sundar tikau from day one, it is not going to happen. So you have to be ready that you end up in spending more money initially, and as you use more and more, it will cost will come down.
Thank you, sir. But last year, I have given a presentation on bamboo architecture in Northeast. So that time I came across through the study that in which they say that we can construct bridges in bamboo with composite, like not only with bamboo, but composite material as a bamboo. So we can construct bridges in bamboo. So now next question is from architect Avni Dhotre. And this is for, again, Karpe sir and Sanjay sir both can address. Is there any training workshops for laborers to get trained for bamboo building construction activities?
Sanjay ji, you can answer. Okay. We have, in Chachpalli, in Chandrapur, we have trained the PWD engineers to proof and to do the quality control for bamboo structures extensively. And now that center, which is a government of Maharashtra project, is proposing to start a training center so that it's in a tribal belt. So there's a lot of potential for people to come and get trained in crafts of various kinds in bamboo as well as in construction. So that is something that is now waiting, and it's imminent, but it's not yet started, I guess.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Next question is for Mr. Sanjay Karpe. It is from Atul Parekh. He is a professional practitioner. The question is, despite India being a higher producer of bamboo, what has been the main deterrent for a wider horizon of use of bamboo in India?
So I think that main deterrent is everybody expects somebody else to do something. So government should they do this, institution should do this, and no, NGO should do this. So now everybody has to start thinking what I can do. No, in 2004 we decided that we will do it. We are trying our level best. I expect everybody to be at least a drop in the ocean, start using this material, at least buy 150 rupees a pen stand in bamboo, and I'm very sure in few years that no, things will change. Without doing that, you don't expect that no, bamboo will automatically take a shape. No, you have to do something. Please start acting on it.
Okay, thank you, sir. The next question.
I'd like to just add to that.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. I'd like to add to that. There are of course all kinds of reasons that a lot of these speakers have spoken about why it's not used, cultural ones, technical ones. As a practicing architect, I want to say that codes have never held us back from practicing this kind of architecture. India has an unusual national, it's part of the National Building Code. There are various chapters, including some misprints that are there in that code, but that's, anyway, that's a different matter. It will probably get sorted out in the next edition. So India has a bamboo code, so does California. Even China, we discovered, does not have a structural bamboo code. When we worked in China, I found out from a specialist in bamboo structure that she used a Mandarin translation of the Indian bamboo code to prove our structures. And so codes are not the problem. The problem really is, like Sandeep said, who's going to do it first? So everybody wants to follow a path which has been created by others. And the only thing is, you should not do it too blindly. So as a practicing architect, if you want to design and make a building in bamboo, you have to realize that all the positives and negatives will come with it. And you have to learn the whole art and science of construction in that way, because it's like saying that if you were to tomorrow start using a completely new material which you have not been trained in, clearly you would have to train yourself. And you cannot be just rosy-eyed about it and think that it's the greatest thing in the world, nor should you be down in the dumps about it and think that nothing can happen. And then something will emerge.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. The next question is by Swastik Chakraborty. He's a student. This is for Mr. Lepcha. Why is not government using bamboo to build low cost and strong houses for any public every housing scheme?
Because depends upon, I already told you that it's a matter of culture. See, I am from bamboo growing area. So for me, decision making is simple. It's, why not? You can make it. But suppose for any mainland Indian born in mainland India, so he has to decide. No? He is not aware with that material. So that is the main hitch. That is why my guide was there. It's more of a culture. So that deep inside our psychology, psyche, so bamboo is a poor man's. So whosoever sits on my position or IS officer or secretary or chief secretary, he thinks that no. Bamboo is very bad material or something like that. No? So it's more of a psychologically problem. Otherwise, decision making, bamboo is so far, but government purpose is a perfect. Government of Uttarakhand, now they are planning for 7 pilot schools in hills, mountains. And probably they will go for thousands, they are saying. So they are started accepting. So it depends upon the decision maker.
Thank you, sir.
Can I add to it?
Yes, Uncle. Yes, please.
See the thing is, there has to be a progressive way to move ahead. The thing is, for example, I sure know that the roof is least vandalized. So, for example, so I am sure that I'll first use the roof. Maybe my walls are stone or some. The thing is that it. See, one of the thing is that when you are using standard material versus when you are using a bamboo, it requires an orientation. That it requires a way to detail out. It requires a way to keep. Now we cannot approach bamboo from the same way we approach steel, and we should not expect bamboo to do same what we expect steel to do it. Because why don't we expect earth to do the same what bamboo, and why don't we expect some other material to? So all materials are different, and the thing is. The thing is, what we have to also understand as a society, the culture of how do we use space, how do we use buildings, and in that light, to me at least, if I have to look at it progressively for government, the first thing has to go for, let's say, spanning members and bearing members in other materials like earth, stone, brick, etc., before one goes to the next level of using, let's say, colonnades or things of those kind. Then progressively you move to the third layer. So slowly we are preparing and getting into it rather than one go, because we will also not get artisans who are that skilled and can do really dignified work at that scale. then people will think that, oh, they, again, this is like they have put the cheapest material and they have done in the worst possible way. I think we have to be very careful when we are putting something in a public front, especially something like bamboo.
Very true. Can we move to next question? It is by Colonel Vivekanand Chaudhary. This question is to Mr. Karpe. Are we working on IS code on bamboo construction management for industrial acceptance by users?
So we already have a code for designing a building with bamboo, which has been revised in 2018. Again, it is 2012 code. Then we have IS code for treatment of bamboo. Then we have IS code for testing of bamboo. So needed IS codes are already there. This code has been revised continuously. So we need improvement in that. But for that also, people need to start using it and giving a feedback to Bureau of Indian Standard. And we can have much better code. If we compare our code with what China have, what ISO have also, I think we have much better codes. And needed codes are already there. Please don't wait for additional codes to come in. Let's start using it first. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Next question is from Dhriti, who is a professional practitioner, and it is for architect Sanjay Prakash. Can we build a bamboo skyscraper? Sir, can you hear me? Sanjay Prakash, sir.
Yeah. So I think I've indirectly answered that already, but let me repeat. Currently, you need to question why you need skyscrapers, because it is now getting more and more established that high density, low rise construction is completely acceptable. It doesn't have to be 20 stories high. Now, you gave me an example of Singapore trying out a bamboo building 120 stories high, and I'd like to hang on till it's made, because it means that they are using it in a totally different way. But anyway, whatever the thing, the fact remains that for multi-story construction, the Canadian six-story building code is probably the best point to start. Because it deals, many chapters in that code deal with fire and its control, as well as, but you know, it's what I said in the beginning. Since India has consistently ironed away a culture of timber building, it's very difficult for us to create a culture of bamboo building. We have, since the 1950s, slowly dissolved all the work done by FRI and ignored this simply on the basis that timber is inflammable. And therefore, we have given up the idea of timber buildings. Although, timber is the only sustainable material known to humankind, other than thatch and bamboo. So, actually, stones are not sustainable. So, stones are mined. Neither is clinker, nor is cement, nor is steel. These are all processed industrial materials. And therefore, I think it is true that right now, I would not dare to make a codified building beyond 5-6 stories in bamboo. And there aren't good examples of it in India. It's unlikely to be a solution for very high skyscrapers. It's more likely to be some kind of a composite solution which will emerge in the future. But these are early days. The ecosystem for bamboo construction does not yet exist. It is trying to exist through people like Sanjeev. But if you were a practitioner today in one city and you got a chance, some client came to you and said, I'd like to make a building in bamboo, what would you do? Next, you would want a builder who could build it, right? It's not easy. You would need a designer who could design it. You would need a structural engineer on your side who could say, okay, we'll do it. Therefore, that ecosystem has to be built up. piece by piece, and without that you will not get tall building or short building or any building at all, unless we build up that ecosystem.
Thank you, sir. Next question, I will address this question because it is related to institutions. It is by Purushottam Verma, and he is asking that, do you agree that being professional, we shall develop technology transfer clusters across nation with the help of architectural institutions, so knowledge can transfer to the root level? Yes, we can do that. And as rightly said by Honorable Suresh Prabhu also, and by all the experts, I think we have to bridge this gap, and we need to reinvent that. I'm doubtful that how many institutions are teaching bamboo as a building material. So we need to consider that, how can we motivate our students to know more about these materials. And as you rightly said, Sankalp, that there is a need for research with the help of all the stakeholders. Like, industry experts are knowing their limitations because they are working with it, so they can share the limitations with us. And yes, as an institution, we are having labs, then we are have multidisciplinary in nature, not only architecture, we have civil engineering departments, we have sciences with us, so we can all together take a research project on this, and we should try to solve these problems, so that, as rightly said by Mr. Karpe also, let it be the ocean in the drop. If you use at least, because there are limitations for all the materials. Now, as per the limit scope, strengths and materials of the materials, we should decide where to use and where not to use. So if we start using just a product of bamboo, or just we can decide what elements of buildings can be prepared with bamboo, where it is suitable, so it is possible, and then we can help our country to become again the Atmanirbhar Bharat. And the last question,
to add to what you were saying, look, see, one of the things which we have to work with is engineers. Often I find from some of the technical institutions, joineries that are coming out are so bulky, so aesthetically unappealing, that suddenly you find that, I mean, why are you doing this? Because better to use steel than to use this joinery completely. And so I think that unless and until both the engineers, the design team come together and really start developing it together, and we have seen many successful examples, it won't be to a level of scalability. Because in order to have scale, it is not the architects with whom we have to work, but it is the engineers with whom we have to work in the country. Because majority of the work and influences are still under the control of civil engineers and not under the control of architects by any chance and by any ways. So we need to little bit look at it from also from support from National Bamboo Mission and other organization to sort of look at from this perspective. Because if civil engineers are not ready, if they are not ready to work with it, then it will not reach to a level to which we want.
Very true.
I need to just butt in a bit. I think because I worked in China, which is a nation which has got pretty much half the mayors are economists, the other half are civil engineers, and they control the whole nation. This is just to say that, believe it or not, there is no construction material they will build in except steel and concrete. They will simply not use bamboo. They don't have bamboo cords. They have 1930s textbooks in Mandarin which tell you about how to make a bamboo bridge and stuff like that, which I saw on a footpath in Shanghai. But they do not have a formal orientation in bamboo construction, so much so that even though China uses a lot of bamboo, it uses it for beer, it uses it for clothes, it uses it for food, and all kinds of things that Mr. Suresh Prabhu was talking about, it doesn't really use it for structures. Even in China, the bamboo house is considered a poor man's house. Which is not to say that we should pat ourselves on the back, it's just to say that this is the state that it is in the world.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. I think we have addressed all the questions. And there is one question by, I think we all have addressed. The question is, how can we promote the use of bamboo in India, by Nikhil? But we have, I think, already addressed this question. So because of time constraint, we'll stop here. Now I'll request our Professor Dr. Anuradha Chatterjee to sum up and to give vote of thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Madhura. It's very difficult to sum up a fantastic series of presentations by our experts, and by no means I'm an expert, so I'm absolutely humbled and inspired by what I've heard today. I hope everybody who joined has stuck around till the end, because and I hope, like me, you learned a lot about what are the possibilities of bamboo, what are the limitations, what are the cultural barriers, what are the commercial barriers, and what are the opportunities. I think we've already addressed where institutions, educational institutions, can play a role, and I think we touched upon laboratories and teaching students. But and I think what we need, going back to what Mr. Lepcha was saying about a cultural barrier, that this is something I think as institutions we have to collectively take a role in create and being advocates, and not just sensitizing, but being advocates of bamboo and architecture and construction, whether it is through joint projects with practitioners or government or a triangulation of all different stakeholders. But I think it's something that really needs to be done. And also whether even they are continuing professional development programs for architects and industry practitioners as well. So just because you don't know about it, it's again a fear of the unknown. What you don't know, you're afraid of, and you don't recognize, you don't see the value in it. So I think it's not just I wonder if the profession and the academy can join hands in creating professional development programs for engineers, for builders, for architects, as well as students, which I think is something, as the Dean of Faculty of Design, is something that we would be very keen to kind of look at in the future. So thank you very much. Starting with Honorable Suresh Prabhu's speech, Mr. Lepcha, Architect Sanjay Prakash, Mr. Sanjeev Karpe, and Professor Sankalpa, thank you so much for being with us today. I'm sure everybody's incredibly inspired to have heard this talk this afternoon. Thank you so much. Please come back again soon.
Thank you so much, and I would like to thank all the participants for being patient for I think two hours almost. So thank you all the participants, and there are dignitaries also in the participants, so I would like to thank all of them, and definitely we will take this mission ahead. So thank you so much to all of you, and I am signing off. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.